NATO commander in Afghanistan, General John Campbell. And General, first, I want to thank you for being here. You were with this committee in October, and I'm not sure we expected to see you again so soon, but I understand that you will be transitioning to out of the Army, and so we wanted to take this opportunity to get ourselves updated and get your insights on the status in Afghanistan. As we do that, I want to express appreciation for your service to the country over many distinguished years, and I especially want to express my appreciation and admiration for the way you have conducted this job in, I believe, your third deployment in Afghanistan. It seems to me that you have walked something of a tightrope because it's clear to me that you appreciate the importance of Afghanistan to our country's security, as well as the investment in lives and treasure that the United States has made there over the years. And at the same time, in many ways, you have had your hands tied by the White House on what you could and could not do. It seems, in some ways, we have a contradiction for Afghanistan. It was known as the good war, and yet, at least some in the White House are unwilling to allow the military to take the steps to actually. Be successful. My view is that this is a crucial time in Afghanistan. We all read the press reports about the growing presence of ISIS. We read about the Taliban being more aggressive, partly because of their internal power struggles, I suspect, partly because they're trying to position themselves for any peace talks that may come. There are some who believe that Al-Qaeda is regrouping in the area, and there are a number of other groups. And yet, our commitment to Afghanistan seems to come at a year at a time, which causes some question about how reliable a partner we are. So I think that the committee and the American people are looking forward to an update of the status of the situation today in Afghanistan. I think we are all interested in whether the Afghans are making progress in developing their military and in being able to handle their own security needs effectively. And I also think the committee and the American people need continue to ask, why are we still here 14 years later? Why is it important? And so I hope that over the course of the day, you can help us explore some of the answers to those questions. Let me turn, Mr. Smith is not with us this week because of health concerns. So let me turn to the gentlelady from California, Ms. Sanchez, for any comments she'd like to make.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll begin by asking unanimous consent to put Mr. Smith's remarks in for the record.
Without objection.
And I would like to make a few comments. First of all, to thank General Campbell for your distinguished service and for this time now, as the chairman said, the third deployment that you have as our commander and of our forces there in Afghanistan. So thank you, and we wish you luck in your future endeavors. It's evident that the situation in Afghanistan has become more complex as the Taliban continues to provoke instability in that country. And while ISIL-affiliated terrorist groups such as the Islamic State in the Khorasan province endeavor to gain some influence in Afghanistan. For the past 14 years, the U.S. has not only fought in Afghanistan, but we have funded and we have invested in so many areas of Afghanistan society. And no one can deny the progress that we have made in reducing Al-Qaeda terrorists in Afghanistan. And a lot of that credit goes to, of course, our military men and women, but also to our civilian men and women who have been in there, and the groups who have worked on that whole issue of trying to weave together the fabric of society for the Afghan people. However, when we look at the situation in the Middle East, and I include Afghanistan because groups are moving back and forth and playing influence or trying to gain influence there, it continues to, I think, threaten the United States security and our security when we look at sanctuaries in particular in Afghanistan for some of these terrorist organizations. General, last week your successor, Lieutenant General Nicholson, stated during his nomination hearing as commander that he would continue to pursue counterterrorism and advise and assist in capabilities in Afghanistan. We have about 9,800 troops deployed in Afghanistan right now, and I know that the plan is to bring them down to about 5,500 by the end of this year. So, considering all of the evolving threats in the country, and looking at the progress we have made or the lack of some of the progress, for example, with Afghan National Defense and Security Forces, we are very interested to try to figure out and help and glean some understanding from you about what our real role will be there. Because after 14 years, using your own words, General Campbell, an uneven and inconsistent performance from the Afghan forces. And considering this advise and assist capability is a significant part of our strategy in Afghanistan, I'm concerned that we really still haven't seen the signs that if we were effectively to leave, that the Afghan forces could really continue to create that stability for that country and for its people. And I have expressed my concerns over and over on the high level of corruption that we have seen in all the Afghan governments since we began 14 years ago there. So I'm interested to hear where that is headed and what you think is happening with the whole issue of corruption. And with that, I'll yield back, Mr. Chairman, and thank you.
Thank you. Without objection, General, your full written statement will be made part of the record, and you're recognized for any comments you'd like to make.
Sir, thank you. Good morning, Chairman Thornberry, Ms. Sanchez, and other distinguished members of this committee. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today while representing the great servicemen and women of the United States Forces Afghanistan. And I've been honored to lead and represent them in all that they do for nearly 18 months, and it has truly been my honor and privilege to do so. I'd like to begin by thanking the committee for your steadfast support of our soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and civilians. And due to your leadership and commitment, they continue to be the best trained and equipped force our nation has ever deployed. Their remarkable performance bears testimony to your backing and the backing of the American people. I'd also like to recognize the unsung heroes of our nation, and that's our military families. And they have stood by us for the last 14 plus years of conflict. They endure the hardships of our frequent absences and allow us to focus on our mission. Without their love and support, we couldn't succeed. And we thank them for their continued support. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge and honor the over 2,200 servicemen and women who have died since 2001 and the over 20,000 who have been wounded. Tragically, we recently lost 6 U.S. airmen to a motorcycle-borne IED just before Christmas and a special forces advisor just after the new year. These losses remind us that Afghanistan remains a dangerous place. And while we take every measure to reduce force protection threats, our service members, civilians, and coalition partners remain in harm's way. We also remember the fallen of the Afghan security forces and the loved ones that they leave behind. They now bear the brunt of this conflict as they fight to bring peace and security to Afghanistan. Every day we honor their memories by assisting our Afghan partners as they fight to improve security and, by extension, to help protect our homeland. Let me say that again, help protect our homeland. The men and women I serve with have not forgotten why we are in Afghanistan. We remain there to ensure that another terrorist attack originating from Afghanistan and directed against the U.S. homeland will never happen again. That is why the counterterrorism mission remains critical to our mutual security interests. Yet we recognize the importance of our train, advise, and assist mission as we build a sustainable Afghan security force, capable of standing alone in its mission of countering violent extremists and denying terrorist safe haven. This is a shared vital interest among Afghanistan, the United States, and the international community. Those who serve in this mission understand that Afghanistan is worth our investment. It is their commitment that keeps us focused on our vision for a stable and secure Afghanistan. Together, the train, advise, and assist mission and the efforts there, coupled with our counterterrorism mission, underpin overall mission success. Just 4 months have passed since I last appeared before this committee. Even in that short time, there have been many developments in the security situation. The progress of the Afghan government and its security forces, our coalition's commitment, and of course, the U.S. way ahead in 2016 and beyond. Today, I will speak to these developments and answer questions you may have on the state of our efforts and the overall situation in Afghanistan. Specifically, I'd like to address a lesson we learned from last year, how we intend to ensure that 2016 is different from 2015, and how we see 2017 and beyond. To assess these questions, we must ask ourselves, what else can we do to enable the Afghan security forces? And what else can the Afghans do for themselves to ensure the security of their country? 2015 was fundamentally different than previous years of our campaign. It is important to remember this context as we assess our efforts in Afghanistan. First, Afghanistan's government and security forces have managed multiple transitions in 2015. Second, the U.S. and coalition mission and force structure have significantly changed. And third, changing regional dynamics, including evolving threats, have presented both challenges and opportunities for our success. As I travel around Afghanistan, I recognize the changes and progress made over the years of this mission. As the chairman said, this is my third deployment to Afghanistan over the span of the last 14 years, and I've served as a senior commander there for the last 18 months. I'm ever mindful of how far we've come, but I do remain clear-eyed about the challenges that lie ahead. Now more than ever, the United States should not waver on Afghanistan. The crucial investment we're making provides dividends that achieve our strategic goals, secure our homeland, and position us well in a region that has been a source of terrorism and instability for decades. Many of you have heard me say that for every bad news story we hear, every story, bad story coming out of Afghanistan, there are 10 good news stories we don't. While this is to be expected, I think it tints the view of our progress and prospects for success in Afghanistan. Today, it is my intent to provide a balanced assessment that not only exposes the challenges that lie ahead, but also illustrates our gains of the Afghan forces. And with that in mind, I'd like to address the concerns over what many feel is an overall declining security situation in Afghanistan. The situation is more dynamic than a simple yes or no answer would adequately address. In fact, as of last week, the units we have on the ground throughout the country reported that of the 407 district centers, 8 of them, or just 2%, are under insurgent control. Let me say that again. Out of the 407 districts, only 8 of them are under insurgent control. We assess that another 18 or 4% are under what we call insurgent influence. Often these district centers are in remote and sparsely populated areas that security forces are not able to access every day and usually not enforce. Additionally, at any given time, there may be up to 94 district centers or 23% that we view as at risk. These figures make two clear points. One, that approximately 70% of the inhabited parts of Afghanistan are either under government influence or government control. And number two, the importance of prioritizing Afghan resources to ensure that key district centers do not fall into insurgent influence or control. Over the last 8 years, the Afghan security forces have made advancements, beginning as an unorganized collection of militia and developing into a modern security force, with many systems and processes of an advanced military. You know, too many times we try to compare the Afghan security forces with the U.S. Army. The U.S. Army has been around for 240 years. Again, the Afghan Army, about 8 years. They have proven resilient and continued to make significant strides in only the second year in which Afghan forces assumed the lead for security throughout Afghanistan. They have demonstrated the ability to successfully conduct effective, large-scale, multi-pillar operations across the country, including in Helmand, Ghazni, and Nangarhar. Following insurgent offenses, the Afghan security forces were able to retake key territory, as they did in Kunduz back in October, with strong performances from the security pillars. Simultaneously, while tactical units were conducting these operations, the security institutions had to continue developing the force. This includes many complex tasks, such as budgeting, force generation, personnel management, national-level maintenance, logistics, and procurement. These are areas that challenge even the most advanced militaries in the world. I'd like to say that we have accomplished here is akin to building an airplane while in flight. And while these systems are far from perfect, the foundation has been laid. And we continue to advise and assist the Afghans as they build a sustainable security force that is enduring and capable of standing on its own. With Afghans in the lead for security for the first time in 2015, the enemy and the naysayers predicted the collapse of the Afghan security forces and the Afghan government. They sought to capitalize on it. Instead, the Afghan security forces fought for their very survival of their country and held firm. They did not fracture, and they kept the insurgents from achieving their strategic goals while inflicting higher casualties on the enemy. They did this while maintaining a significantly higher operational tempo with significantly reduced coalition support. However, the lessons learned in 2015 underscore that Afghan shortfalls will persist well beyond 2016. Capability gaps still exist in fixed and rotary wing aviation, combined arms operation, intelligence collection and dissemination, and maintenance. And more prominently, one of the greatest tactical challenges for the Afghan security forces has been overcoming the Afghan Air Force's extremely limited organic close air support capability. Admittedly, we began building the Afghan Air Force late and are constrained by the time it takes to build human capital. Those capability gaps notwithstanding, I still assess that at least 70% of the problems facing the Afghan security forces result from poor leadership. Minister of Defense Stan Exai recognizes this as well. And to date, the Afghan National Army has replaced 92 general officers, including the 215th Corps commander in Helmand. The Ministry of Interior is lagging behind in making leadership changes, but we are taking steps to remedy this through our train, advise, and assist mission. But this kind of change takes time. I've seen the consequences of Kunduz and Helmand still weigh heavily on the leadership of both the security forces and the Afghan government. They realize that although not strategically significant in a pure military sense, that those incidents shape media coverage and undermine the confidence in the Afghan government. Their desire to do better runs deep and is genuine. And in many ways, these events forced a greater sense of urgency to make the changes they greatly require. Over the last year, there have been many positive trends. However, Afghan security forces have not consolidated significant gains of their own, nor defeated the insurgency across Afghanistan. And suffice it to say, their performance this year was uneven. To be fair, this was not unexpected, given the overall conditions. Ultimately, Afghanistan has not achieved an enduring level of security and stability that justifies a reduction in our support in 2016. That is why the President's decision to maintain current force levels through most of 2016 was welcome and important. This decision set the example for NATO, encouraging other allies and partner nations to maintain, or in some cases, increase their contributions to the Resolute Support mission. During this winter lull, we are focusing on steps to best prepare the Afghan security forces for the summer campaign of 2016. Their leadership shares this focus, and they are dedicated to resetting the force. Implementing reforms to improve training, equipping, and rebuilding of units that have endured unusually high operational tempos for long periods of time, especially those forces in Helmand. Such reforms are critical and are taking root with the Afghan security forces, but broader reforms remain important to the success in Afghanistan. The Afghan government, including its security institutions, continues to show progress in battling corruption and achieving other reforms such as gender integration. However, much work still needs to be done. We fully understand that many want to see more progress on social and human rights issues before continuing to commit resources to Afghanistan. The National Unity Government also recognizes this and has welcomed our increased use of conditionality to usher change. They understand the importance of stability, opportunity, and hope. The hope that inspires people to stay in Afghanistan instead of seek an opportunity elsewhere. Afghanistan is at an inflection point. I believe if we do not make deliberate, measured adjustments, 2016 is at risk of being no better and possibly worse than 2015. To place this in context, I'd like to emphasize the uniqueness of 2015 and some dynamics I think we should consider as we assess our way ahead. The enemy has also changed this year. Unlike previous years, the Taliban extended the fighting season and has continued to conduct operations in Helmand as called by for the Taliban leadership. And even so, the Taliban recognize they have no lasting gains to consolidate from last year. They cannot afford to cede the limited ground they do hold. They also had a coming out year that saw fracturing of their organization, competition from among insurgent groups resulting in a loss of legitimacy and high casualty rates, probably their highest casualty rates in years. As I meet with Afghan soldiers and police, I remind them that the Taliban are not 10 feet tall and are not bulletproof. They face significant challenges and they can be defeated. This fact is often forgotten in prominent media reports. The brief notoriety that the Taliban have gained in Kunduz and Helmand is still overshadowed by the significant cost of those efforts, compounded by the loss of credibility and the unity as enemy infighting continues to this day. The Taliban's public narrative in Afghanistan is waning too. It is not lost on the people of Afghanistan that the Taliban are killing Afghans, security forces, and innocent civilians alike. Recent public information campaigns have also been more forceful, stressing to the public that the Taliban, they have no plan for the development of Afghanistan. They are here to kill you. They are against women. They are against education. And they are against progress for the nation of Afghanistan. As these messages resonate, the government must show that it is the only viable option for Afghanistan. At the city, district, provincial, and national levels, the people of Afghanistan see that the return of the Taliban represents a return to brutality, criminality, and oppression. The operating environment is also evolving for the Taliban due to the emergence of insurgent and terrorist groups. One such group is Daesh in Afghanistan, or Islamic State, Khorasan province. Daesh continues to conduct brutal attacks against civilians and directly competes with the Taliban for resources to establish a foothold in the country. They have focused their efforts on establishing a presence in Nangarhar and in recruiting in other areas. We recently gained the authority to strike Daesh. Since then, we have had considerable success in degrading their capabilities. The rejection of Daesh by local leaders who are working with Afghan security forces has also slowed the enemy's progress. The strikes have been effective in mitigating their growth. We must maintain constant pressure on Daesh and dedicate intelligence resources to prevent strategic surprise. The Taliban has had to adjust their strategy this year in order to counter the emergence of Daesh and other insurgent groups. This dynamic has served as a distraction to the Taliban, requiring them to shift precious resources from fighting the Afghan security forces to countering opposition groups. More than just consuming resources, the infighting and resultant inability to maintain cohesion also has severely damaged the credibility of the Taliban's core narrative of being a strong, united organization. Groups aligned with the Taliban, such as Al-Qaeda and the Haqqani network, continue to threaten our national security interests. Al-Qaeda has been significantly weakened, but as evidenced by the recent discovery of an Al-Qaeda camp on Afghanistan's southern border, they are certainly not extinct. The Haqqani network remains the most capable threat to the U.S. and coalition forces, planning and executing the most violent, high-profile attacks in Kabul. These are certainly not residual threats that would allow for a peaceful transition across Afghanistan. Instead, they are persistent threats that are adapting to a changing operational environment. Ultimately, the threats Afghanistan faces requires our sustained attention and forward presence. Reconciliation is a path needed to obtain a negotiated settlement and end the conflict in Afghanistan. Current reconciliation efforts are an Afghan-led, Afghan-owned initiative, recently renewed with a quadrilateral meeting in mid-January that included Afghanistan, Pakistan, the United States, and China. It has been over a year since the formation of the National Unity Government. It has faced institutional and political difficulties, yet can lay claim to some meaningful reform and progress during its first year. The Unity Government may be fragile, but it is holding. Despite being challenged, it is making progress and building momentum to create increasingly a viable future for the Afghan people. Politically, Afghanistan is postured for both progress and a continued strategic partnership with the United States. We have a strong and willing partners in President Ghani and CE Chief Executive Abdullah. And as all of you know, this has not always been the case in our relationship in Afghanistan. So as I said at the beginning of this statement, we now ask ourselves, what else can we do to enable the Afghan security forces? And what else can the Afghans do for themselves to secure their country? Nor is it true to the reason we came here over 14 years ago. A strategic stalemate without end is not the goal of this campaign. Let me say that again. A strategic stalemate without end is not the goal of this campaign, and our men and women on the ground know that. In fact, the recently submitted NATO strategic assessment makes recommendations for adjustments to the current NATO op plan that my best military advice will help push the campaign past this inflection point and increase the prospect of increasing our shared goals and achieving our shared goals. The measures that NATO is considering include advisory adjustments to give commanders more flexibility on the ground and shifting from a yearly outlook to a five-year vision to give all donor nations, and especially Afghanistan, the confidence that comes with predictability of support. The United States must consider and must continue to show flexibility with our mission in 2016 and beyond. As a commander, I'm responsible for aligning our national objectives with ways and means while managing risk. Now that we have been allocated our resources for 2016, I am assessing the ways in which we ensure that 2016 is not a rerun of 2015. Based on conditions and the performance of the Afghan security forces during this winter lull, I'm also reviewing how well those forces will likely perform in 2017 and the United States and coalition resources required for their continued development. This is all part of a broader process, of which my assessment is only one part. I will provide my assessments of our strategy to my military leadership, as well as my successor, Mick Nicholson. I think it's important to remember that this time last year, our plan was to transition to 1,000 troops, Kabul-centric footprint. Due to conditions on the ground, the President made the decision to extend 9,800 through most of 2016 and increased our posture to 5,500 in 2017. This decision provided flexibility to make adjustments and represents the kind of conditions-based approach that is so important for our mission in Afghanistan. Key to this long-term success in the region is the resiliency of the Afghan government and its security institutions, and the ability to serve as a regional partner in our combined efforts to counter violent extremism. And it's important to remember that the National Union Government welcomes our assistance. They are dependable and steadfast counterterrorism partners in South Asia. 2017 marks a significant change in our approach as we focus our efforts to capitalize on the gains of the past decade and build the capacity of the Afghan security institutions. We now have a window of opportunity to increase our likelihood of achieving strategic success. Of course, our support should not be open-ended, and I believe our approach is sound. This year, we will apply greater conditionality to the Afghans in managing the resources we give them. We are also developing a five-year vision out to 2020 to help better define what we are trying to accomplish and avoid a year-to-year mentality. I believe that by changing our and our Afghans' mindset from a cyclic fighting season to fighting season, view to a really genuine long-term outlook that really best reflects our commitment. We need to provide the Afghans a time and space for them to continue to build their resiliency and their capability. Through their spirit and fortitude, they have proven worthy of our continued support. The actions we take now, combined with their resolve to improve, will over time develop a sustainable force capable of securing the nation and in turn help us secure ours. So thank you again for having the opportunity, for your steadfast support of this, for this campaign, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, sir. And I know that members of the committee will have a number of aspects that you mentioned that they'll want to follow up on. Let me just pursue one issue right quick. You made the point that one of our key goals is to prevent another terrorism attack on the homeland. About a month ago, there was an article in the Wall Street Journal that pointed out that 5 years ago, the U.S. military and its allies operated 852 bases and outposts in Afghanistan, many with their own informants, drones, and surveillance balloons. Now, all but about 20 of them are closed. And then it goes on to talk about the Al-Qaeda training camp that was 30 square miles in southern Kandahar that was a complete surprise to us. So it just seems to me as a matter of common sense that when you go from 852 installations to 20, that it is harder to keep up with the enemy and to prevent another attack on our homeland. Isn't that true?
Sure, it's true. As we downsize, we lose sensors, we lose force out in other regions of Afghanistan to be able to detect that. The intent, though, is to continue to build the Afghan forces so they can take over many of those places that we departed, sir.
Well, I'm concerned that that we are not giving you the resources or the leeway to protect the homeland and advise and assist the Afghans to take care of security so that we can turn it over to them. Let me just ask one other thing. You mentioned that NATO is looking at a five-year vision to replace the fighting season to fighting season, and I hope to replace the year-to-year U.S. Decision-making on whether we're going to be there or not. What is that decision going to rest on? What's going to decide whether NATO has a five-year approach to Afghanistan versus this lurching from a few months to a few months?
So I think, again, and sir, thanks for the question. We approached NATO through the Chiefs of Defense a week or two ago, talked about Afghanistan as we move toward the Warsaw conference in July of this year, where all the nations will come together, the donor nations will come together, and look at providing funding for Afghanistan for 2018, 2019, and 2020. So tying Warsaw and the funding that they have to the narrative that we have to have a long-term commitment just made sense. And I think what the donor nations, NATO, will continue to look at, are the Afghans getting at what we need them to get at? Are their security forces improving? Are they getting after corruption? Are they trying to work women into the security institutions? Are they going after the insurgents that have caused problems in Afghanistan? So I think as they see the Afghan security forces continue to improve, that gives the donor nations continued hope that they'll continue to improve, and I do believe they will. But as they move toward this five-year plan, I do think for the U.S. as well that we have to come to a longer-term plan. You know, as early as 2009, when we were surging, we were also talking about coming down. And for many of the Afghan people and the security forces, as I talked to them, they remain skeptical that we will continue to be there. We tell them that. They know by the decision in October 15 by President Obama that we will have a longer-term commitment. And as you would suspect, many of the Afghan security forces want larger numbers. They want more resources. They understand they have gaps and seams that they need to continue to work on. And they see NATO and especially the United States as the only ones that can really help them get to the level they need to get to. But I think if we have a narrative that we show them that we have long-term commitment, not only in the money, but in people on the ground, in the systems and equipment, in the training that continue to come into the country, it'll build more confidence for the Afghan security institutions and for the people in Afghanistan.
Well, I hope the U.S. Provides that leadership, because it seems to me that the concern that we're not going to be there very long has made the job of you and our troops more difficult, whether it be counterterrorism or the train and assist mission. Ms. Sanchez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, in Iraq, we had left Iraq pretty much, and we had left a trained up Iraqi army and police forces. And over the years that we were there, hundreds of thousands of people were trained and equipped into those forces over the decade or so that we were doing that. And yet, when ISIL came to the battle, the Iraqi forces ran, left their weapons and the armaments that we had given to them, and we find ourselves in the situation in Iraq now fighting a strengthened ISIL and trying to rebuild what we thought we had built in Iraq. Tell me how Afghanistan differs. Tell me why you think those that we are training up will not run or leave the weapons behind should there be a strong ISIL-type force that tries to take land there for their training camps or whatever their desires are. Why would we not expect the same thing to happen in Afghanistan if we would withdraw?
Thank you for the question, ma'am. I spent about 19 months in Iraq as well, and I've watched the Afghan forces since I was a colonel in 2002, 2003, all the way up to four-star now in 2016. The Afghans are fighters. They have a different sense of pride, I think, and nationalism in their country. In Iraq, it was about Sunni-Shia Kurd issues. In Afghanistan, they see themselves, although different tribal affiliations, they are one Afghanistan force, fighting for their country, fighting for their survival. So as I talk to the Afghan senior leadership, you know, it's obvious to me that they will not do what happened in Iraq based on what's coming from their heart from Afghanistan to protect their country. We continue to work with them. We have had a glide slope over the last 3, 4, 5 years as we come out of the Kandaks, the battalion level, the brigades, that we're just focused on the ministerial level and on the core level, and then we do tactical level TAA, train, advise, assist at the special operating level, and we continue to build those forces there. So I see a continued commitment by the Afghan forces over 2015, where they've been on their own, where they've been challenged, that they have not dropped their weapons and run. The only case, actually two cases that I've been disappointed was in Kunduz. And there's a lot of other reasons on Kunduz and why that happened. And then in Helmand, where there have been some isolated district centers where, even though they may have had some of the requisite force, they didn't have the right leadership that inspired the Afghan soldiers or police to stay there and fight. Some of them felt threatened, some of their families were threatened, so they left a few of those district centers there. So only two cases where I've been disappointed. But the change is that they've gone back and they fought for those. They regrouped. In Kunduz, within a couple of days, they retook Kunduz, which is a city of over 300,000. Same thing in Helmand. They continue to fight today, and the district centers, the ones that they had, that they have lost, they have fought for. So I see that change. The other difference between Iraq and I think Afghanistan is the national unity government. You know, they want us there. President Ghani, Dr. Abdullah, the people I deal with in Afghanistan that I talk to want the United States. They want NATO. They see us as a foundational partner, not only in counterterrorism to build their capabilities so they can fight that in that region, but also to continue to build on the rest of their conventional army. President Ghani, and you all heard him when he was here last March when he addressed Congress, about how he thanked the American people for the sacrifice of their men and women, how he thanked the American taxpayers for their continued monetary investment in Afghanistan. He and the rest of the government know how important, you know, we have been. I just don't see Afghanistan as Iraq. I don't see the Afghans running. But it's going to take continued train, advise, and assist, persistent train, advise, and assist, and many of those gaps and seams that we said will be hard for any military to grow, logistics, intelligence, and especially, as I've talked before, their close air support capability.
General, how much longer do you think it will take? Because I'm looking at the budget numbers, and it looks like from 2015 to 2017, the U.S. and its NATO allies have committed to providing $5.1 billion for the Afghan National Defense and Security Force of 352,000 personnel. $4.1 billion of those dollars is the responsibility of the United States. So given that we've been there for 14 years and we can't leave yet, how many 4.1 billion times are we going to do this before we can figure out that we can get out? I mean, I know we've tried all sorts of strategies. We went in because initially because the Taliban had given lands in whatever way for al-Qaeda to train, to come after us in something like a 9/11 attack. Then we went in and fought. Then we put in Karzai. We worked with Karzai. And then we went back to the Taliban, and we cut deals with the Taliban. Now, so, what? I mean, how much longer? I mean, you're our expert because you're there. And you're leading our forces in conjunction with what's going on there. How much longer? How many more 5.1 billion couple of years are we going to have there?
Thank you, ma'am. You know, put in context, a couple of years ago, it was about $12.5 billion. So what we try to do and what we've been able to do over the last several years is continue to bring that cost down. And we're committed to continue to get an affordable, efficient, and sustainable Afghan security force. And to do that, we take a look at how we can save money, how we can make them more efficient. And the $5.1 billion through all of the donor nations, we're going to continue to try to bring that down over the years. But I do believe we're going to need the 352,000 for the Afghan security forces at least through 2020, and that's what we're talking about at Warsaw when we go for 2017, 18, 19, and 20 to get the money to fund that. But the amount of money we're putting in infrastructure to build them, their training ranges, to build them, their compounds that they live at, you know, we're not doing that anymore. We've come way off of that. So the money that we provide continues to pay for the salary of the Afghan police and the army. And then we continue to look at life cycle management of equipment, of ammunition, of those kind of things. So I think other reports would tell you that the Afghans will not be able to pick up that bill totally based on their economy till probably about 2024. You know, $500 million they're required each year to provide to their security forces. That's the commitment that was made in Chicago in 2012. And we want them to continue to raise that every single year. And they have done that the last 2 years. And so we're really pushing them to continue to grow their commitment, to show that that they're doing that. But at the same time, we have to look at ways to make their military more affordable, sustainable, and efficient as we move forward. And so I think the 5.1 will continue to come down, and we'll still be able to hold the 352 at that level, at least for the next 3, 4, 5 years there.
But if I heard you correctly, you believe personally that we have to be committed at least till 2020, and that from a budget standpoint, if all goes well in Afghanistan, they might be able to sustain their own army without us helping in 2024.
Ma'am, I believe that we need a long-term commitment to Afghanistan, both in a forward presence there and also in the money that not only the U.S. but the rest of the donor countries provide.
Yeah, I know the rest of them do, but when I'm looking at $5.1 billion, 4.1 of it is coming from us. So, yes, ma'am. I mean, we are the majority stakeholder.
Absolutely.
This. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the time. Just trying to get some clarification on where we are and where we're going.
Mr. Jones.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. And, General, I did listen to your testimony. I read your testimony. I have great respect for you. And my frustration is the same that Ms. Sanchez is talking about. You know, there's an article. You have pretty much verified this in a way. It says U.S. was supposed to leave Afghanistan in 2017. Now it might take decades. That could be 20, 30, 40 years. I have heard people in the same position that you have and you will soon be leaving, who I have great respect for, to continue to talk about for the 14 years of training the Afghan security forces. And we are making progress. But we've been making progress for 14 years. And now we're talking about more years to train the Afghan security forces. The American people are just, they're not upset with the Afghans, they're upset with Congress. You know, we're spending all this money over there. Let me just very quickly, John Sopko to the Senate this past week testified among the more egregious examples of boondoggles he cited, importing rare blonde Italian goats to boost the Kashmir industry. The $6 million program, including shipping 9 male goats to Western Afghanistan from Italy, setting up a farm, a lab, and a staff to certify their wool. This has nothing to do with you or our great military, but this is where the American people are just sick and tired. And Mr. Sopko testified, we don't know if we used the wool for the fur from the goats or we ate them, meaning the Afghans. This is why this has got to come to a satisfactory end, and there's got to be someone that follows behind you, in my humble opinion, that is going to say to the Congress, we're going to have a benchmark. And if the Afghan security forces cannot meet that benchmark, we're not going to continue to bankrupt the American people. We right now are $18.9 trillion in debt. We will this year hit $19 trillion. It was the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs, Admiral Mike Mullins, who said, the biggest threat to our military is the debt. And he said it when we were a heck of a lot less than $19 trillion. So along with Ms. Sanchez, I want to say that you have been an outstanding leader of our military, like so many. But when you really come down to it, the responsibility, we take your advice and supposed to make the best decisions that we can. But when I look at all the waste, fraud, and abuse in Afghanistan, much of it coming from the Pentagon, not just the Afghans, but the Pentagon, it is not fair to the American people. It's not fair to our military. Right here in the Military Times, they're talking about that here we go again, possibly giving our military a 1.6% increase. That's just way under the private sector. They deserve the very best, and I know you believe that because you've advocated for them, and I want to thank you for that. So since the chairman knows sometimes I run over, I don't even have a question today. I just want to make my point for the citizens of the 3rd District of North Carolina who pay their taxes, love the military in eastern North Carolina, the home of Camp Lejeune Marine Base, as you know. But they know that our policy in Afghanistan, there is no end point to it. It's just going to go on for the next 20 or 30 years. So with that, Mr. Chairman, to make you happy, I'll yield back the balance of my time.
Will the gentleman yield? Will the gentleman yield?
Gentleman yields back. Ms. Davis.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And to you, General Campbell, I certainly want to thank you for your dedication. Those of us who've had a chance to work with you and visit with you in Afghanistan really know and understand that. I particularly wanted to thank you, really, for your understanding and more than that, your direction in the empowerment of Afghan women, looking at gender issues, not just really as it supports the women, the education, the health care, but as it really addresses their own national security. And we know that that's so critical, and I think their role in law enforcement and also in the military now has changed as a result of many of your efforts, and I appreciate that greatly. I also understand, I think we should have, and we're really negligent in not looking at five-year plans previously. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about that and how is that going to be different than what we've done? And what are those priorities that you would appeal, I think, to your to General Nicholson and how he structures that? And it's not just the next five, but the five after that, to try and help not just all of us and Americans understand that, but also signaling to the Afghan people, because I think that's really critical. And it's those political objectives that we also need to be worried about, since we know Afghans are leaving in great numbers because they don't have confidence in their own government right now. What can you, how would you structure that? What would you do differently?
Thank you, ma'am, for the question, and thank you, as many members here have traveled to visit our great men and women over there. I know that makes a big impact on them, so thank you. And I think you can almost tie this into what Mr. Jones said as well. Emanating out of Afghanistan, Pakistan, other parts of that world is this thing called terrorism. And if we think terrorism, you know, terrorism knows no boundaries. And terrorism is going to be a generational thing. And so if we think we can just stop and it's going to go away, or people are not going to continue to try to attack Europe or attack our homeland here, then we're naive, we're kidding ourselves. And so we have to be able to continue to have a long-term commitment. You know, we're the most powerful country in the world. We can do anything we want. If we want to stop this terrorism that kills innocent men and women, that has come to the United States on 9/11, that is killing millions and millions of people throughout the world, we have to stand together. This has to be a global effort, not only from Afghanistan, but throughout the world. And President Ghani is trying to work a regional issue and showing that all the countries around Afghanistan need to stay committed to building their own capability to fight terrorism. Again, it's not going to go away whether we put $10 billion for the next 10 years or 4.1. We got to get united. We got to fight this as a global force. And Afghanistan wants to be part of that force, and Afghanistan has the leadership in President Ghani and Dr. Abdullah to be good partners to do that. And that's what inspires me to continue to work with their military as they do that. Talking in terms of a five-year plan, what that does for Afghanistan, it provides the men and women there, the boys and girls going to school, the business people, that, hey, we're committed, we're going to be there. They're not looking over the shoulder that we're going to make another decision to downsize or leave or lose money. You know, the impact of the number of forces we had to where we are today in the last couple of years has had a huge impact on the economy of Afghanistan as we've come out, and they're trying to recoup from that. And President Ghani has some good measures to look forward, but it's not just the security. He's got to look at the political dimension inside of this national unity government. He's got to look at the economy and continue to build on the economy from a regional standpoint. And he's reaching out to get railways, to get power, to get business investment from the Gulf countries into Afghanistan. He's doing all of that. It's just going to take time. So I think my five-year piece would say longer-term commitment. It means to the Afghan security forces, we're there, we're going to continue to have your back. It means to the people in Afghanistan that we're going to be there, we have commitment, we're going to work on their security, help build their security. It means to the Taliban that, hey, we're going to be there. You need to come to the peace table. You know, we're not leaving. And it means to people like Pakistan and the other countries that we need regional partners there to continue to fight this thing.
Could you, General, really, I think my time is up. I wanted you to just address the conditionality for a second in terms of these issues. What what will be different?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. We started last year. We're doing much better now on conditionality. President Ghani welcomes conditionality, and all the money that we have that we put in the MOI and the MOD, we put conditions on it. You must do this, this, or this, or you don't get this or that. We're trying to do better on incentives as well, to have incentives, both a carrot and a stick there. They welcome that. It helps drive them to maintain better, efficient use of the money that we have there.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Lamborn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Campbell, I want to thank you for your service to our country and the great job that you're doing, and we all feel that way. It's been said before, but I wanted to echo that. A previous question implied that we made a good handoff to the Iraqis, and I think that that's the farthest thing from the truth possible. I think we abandoned them and really put no effort into a status of forces agreement and an American presence that would have supplied some kind of advising and backup and support that I think would have made a huge difference when ISIS came across the border from Syria into Iraq. And so I think the way we abandoned Iraq is part of why ISIS is in Iraq. But having said that, in Afghanistan, we all want to see it done differently. And we want to see the kind of transition that makes them a stable country and able to stand on their own two feet. So I think we're all in support of that. Are you concerned, General Campbell, that there are people out there in our society who want to withdraw from Afghanistan precipitously and not get the job done before they're able to stand on their own two feet?
So from a, you know, I can talk purely from, you know, military perspective. We have to continue to provide the Afghan security forces the ability to stand up on their own feet. They need help in areas that we said they've needed that help for several years: aviation, intelligence, logistics. I think people that may be saying those kind of things may not have an on-the-ground perspective of where the Afghan security forces are at, or how dangerous this thing, terrorism and the insurgent groups, and the safe havens that have been there in the past, will mean to the homeland or Europe if we don't continue to keep pressure on them.
Okay. Thank you. Now, I want to ask you about the rules of engagement. Hot pursuit into Pakistan. Would you like more flexibility when it comes to pursuing people who have committed terrorist or other violent acts and are melting back into Pakistan to be able to strike them, even if they're right at the border?
So as a matter of course, for operational, you know, security reasons, we don't talk about rules of engagement in an open forum. I can talk to you offline if you want to do that.
Okay, thank you. Lastly, I want to ask about a real specific question having to do with American contractors and defense-related companies that I think are sometimes being pressured by the Afghan government or people within the government, people within the bureaucracy, to pay licensing fees or taxes or whatever they call it. But it strikes me that this is contrary to language we've put into the NDAA, that companies don't have to pay those kinds of taxes to do business in Afghanistan. But if they have to pay these for whatever it's called, they're going to really have their ability to get their job done impaired, which will hurt your forces getting their job done. Can you talk about that, please?
Sure, briefly I could. There are, I mean, in the BSA, it specifically states what Afghanistan can do or not do for contractors. And as we work any issues that come up from contractors through the U.S. Embassy there with the Afghan national government, you know, we've come to amenable conclusions on all of that. I think we just have to raise those up. They got to bring that attention forward. Again, President Ghani understands how important it is to bring business in, and they want to make sure they don't do anything to create an obstacle there. But most of that is covered in the bilateral security agreement that was signed. If there's issues, we can take each of those and work those through the U.S. Embassy.
But it's come to my attention that despite the BSA and despite language we've put into the NDAA, this is being abused. This process is being abused.
Sure. The ones that have been brought to my attention have been brought to my folks at work. Any of the procurement issues at Resolute Support, we've been able to work those with the Afghan government. I don't know of these particular ones you're talking about, but maybe I can talk to you afterwards when we get
there. Okay, so if there is a particular issue we become aware of, we can come to your people
Sure, I work with the U.S. Embassy.
And the embassy, okay. All right, thank you very much, General. I yield back.
Mr. Larson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, General. In your testimony, you talked about 2015. In 2016, you wanted to get continued flexibility into 2016. Can you give us an example of what that continued flexibility would mean? What flexibility don't you have, and what flexibility would you propose the mission have in 2016 and 2017?
Sure, thanks for the question. When it comes in terms to what a commander has or doesn't have on the ground, I think you can break it down into bins. It's resources. Resources includes people, it includes equipment, it includes, you know, airplanes. It includes authorities, what you can and can't do. So I think those are really the two that I deal with. All of those, we work assessments. I continually work assessments. We provide that information to our higher headquarters. If we need adjustments to the authorities, if we need additional authorities, if we need to change authorities, I bring that through my chain of command. It works through a broader process, as I talked about, through CENTCOM, through the Joint Staff, through OSD, up to the White House. In 16, you know, we have the number of people we have on the ground. We have the equipment that we have on the ground. We're working toward having the Afghans continue to have a campaign plan as they move forward. And so as we take a look at what else we can do, authority is an area that I would provide my best military advice to my chain of command as we move forward. I don't get into particulars on authorities in an open forum. I can talk to you afterwards. Again, some of these authorities would provide changes in, you know, what we could do to the enemy. And I don't want to talk about that in an open forum to give them any kind of advantage. But I'd be glad to talk to you in a closed hearing on that. But 2017, again, I think is an opportunity to continue to assess how the Afghans have improved over fighting season 16, and do we need to do something different, and do they need to do something different as we go forward. They understand that, you know, the majority, 51% of this is on the Afghans, that they have to continue to get the reforms that we continue to push them on, getting off of checkpoints, getting more maneuverable, reducing the attrition levels that they have, to recruit better, to recontract better, to build upon leadership, to get after corruption, all those kind of things, those reforms, we continue to work with them. They know that, you know, whatever we're going to do is based on how they continue to adjust their own. And if they don't continue to get better, they will lose the confidence of us, they will lose the confidence of the donor nations, and they don't want to do that.
Okay. There was a report this morning, I think, of expanding the amount of dollars for the European Reassurance Initiative, and that money would come from the Overseas Contingency Operations Account, or OCO, which seems to me would put more pressure on available resources in OCO. Assuming that newspaper report is true, and we're going to see that in the budget, just assume it's true for a moment, what impact would that have on the U.S. and the NATO mission in Afghanistan, if in fact the dollars that we thought we were voting for OCO, which would go to Afghanistan and Iraq, are now going to be used for ERI?
Sure, I haven't seen the report. I couldn't comment on the amount or anything like that. But assuming that that Afghanistan was going to take a cut in OCO, you know, I would have to assess on the impact that cut, and I'll go back to leadership and say this is the risk that I would occur because you're taking away OCO. You know, hypothetically, I couldn't answer that, but if I was to lose OCO money, which I do need, then I would take a look at where that was coming from and then the risk that it would mean to my forces.
Yeah, all right. That's good. Thank you very much. Thanks. Yield back.
Mr. Whitman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Campbell, thank you so much for joining us today. Thanks for your service and what you're doing there in Afghanistan. I know it's a challenge. When we met with you back in November, one of the discussions we had with you was about the ANSF close air support capability, what they're doing to develop that, where they are today. Can you give us an update on where those pilots are? I know that they think have completed some training here in the United States, and where are the capability gaps with ANSF close air support capability? I know you point to some resource shortfalls, so can you describe to us where things are there and what needs to happen in the months to come for them to gain that full capability?
Sir, thanks for the question. Again, thanks for your visit as well. So as we've talked in the past, I mean, to build their close air support, their aviation, their air force to what they need with a 352 force, 352,000 force with the enemy threat they face. That's going to continue to take years and years. What has changed since we last saw you? About 2 weeks ago, they received the first four A-29 Super Toscano fixed-wing, for lack of a better term, bombers that are there. And the Afghan pilots are flying those. We'll get them. They'll get them into the mix in combat here in the next couple of weeks. They're doing additional training inside of Afghanistan. There'll be another four that come in probably the April-May time frame, more into 16, 17, and 18 as we build that force up. But for the next large, the next summer campaign fighting season, per se, they'll have about eight of those that are there. The MD-530 Little Bird helicopters we've got over the last year, there's about 14 in country. They continue to get those. They continue to get better and better. They've flown the MD-530s in Nangarhar in combat. They've flown them in Helmand in combat. They've flown them in Kandahar in combat. And they've had very good results. They've learned lessons learned on trying to increase, you know, flight time. They've moved ammunition around to be able to rearm and refuel these helicopters at remote sites. So their capability continues to increase. They're learning lessons on medevac and how they can move their injured on the battlefield with some of their fixed-wing aircraft, how they can tie their Mi-17 helicopters in with their forward-firing Mi-17 helicopters to provide aerial support to go into remote LZs to pick up their wounded, and they've reduced the time. So they continue to build upon that. So it's going to be a continued challenge. It takes 3+ years to get a pilot. They have to recruit now to have pilots for 3 years from now as they continue to build. To build the maintainers there will take 3 to 5 years. Mi-17s will continue to be a challenge. We're not buying any more of those. As they continue to have battle loss or issues with maintaining those, you know, we're going to have to come up with ways to work through that. And we have a study out that looks at a future aircraft. They want to have a U.S. aircraft, helicopter, attack helicopter, and we would have to come back to Congress to ask for continued support to do that. But every day I see the Air Force continue to get better. The Afghan Special Mission Wing, which is that supports our Afghan Special Forces with their helicopters, rotary wing support, is incredible, and what they can do at night. But the conventional forces lack the capability to fly. Many of them can't fly at night, and so we got to continue to build that capability.
I know when we met there, the concern is that the Russians are no longer selling parts to the Mi-17. So how much of a gap do we have in Mi-17 availability in the MD-530s and the capability that they are providing? Because if we have a shrinking capability within our rotor wing force there, that creates a significant issue. So where are we with keeping the Mi-17s flying and closing the gap with the MD-530s?
Sure, thanks. You know, the Mi-17 was never designed to be their close air support helicopter. It was really for transport, for medevac. Yeah. What they did and what we did to help them this year was mitigate that by putting forward firing machine guns in some of the Mi-17s, about 10 of them, and then putting rocket pods on some of the other ones, for a total of about 15 or so that have that. And they continue to do that. But they're losing, based on just wear and tear in the aircraft, combat losses, anywhere between 7 to 10 each year. And we got to continue to work through that. They have issues with overhaul maintenance. The chairman and I talked out the other day on, and as we move forward, what else can we do to work through that? And I owe the chairman some more information on that. But they weren't really designed to complement the MD-530. If I could add one thing, sure. They do have three Mi-35s, really Mi-24s. Yeah. They're Mi-35s from India. They'll have a fourth one coming in pretty soon that will add to their inventory as well, and that'll make a great difference.
In closing, how reliant are they upon U.S. enablers for logistics, maintenance, those kinds of things? Because that has a sustainability leg to it, too, for their aircraft.
Sure, they're relying upon a lot of contractor support, just like the U.S. Army yeah. does a lot of maintenance on our helicopters, ordering with contractor support. They do the same thing. Okay. And so they are very reliant on parts, on contractors as we move in. We'll try to continue to reduce that as we build the Afghan capability.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Ms. Tsongas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, General Campbell. Wish you all the best. I think we'd all like to someday talk about something other than war in Afghanistan. It's a most remarkable country. I know as I've been there and flown over it, and you look down, you can imagine what a very different place it could be if we could only finally get to a place where the country is more stable as we focus on keeping it and preventing it from becoming yet again a safe haven for potential attacks on this country. That's always been our motivator. But I have to say, in my last visit home, we were just back in our districts for a couple of weeks, I had an opportunity to meet with a support group for families of those who'd served, both in Afghanistan and Iraq. And it was really a reminder, as I know it is for all of us who meet with these families, that what a shared sacrifice it is, that as their young people go and serve and come back, the struggles are not over, and that these families have long-term commitments to their young people who've served in our behalfs, and everybody tries to come together to move them to another place in their lives. That's something all of us always have in the backs of our minds. And also, in my many visits there, we can't help but feel good about the many gains that have been made. We've talked about the gains for women. I've been to schools where you've seen the opportunities that creates for their young children. It's remarkable, really. So we all feel pride, and in meeting with Afghans, too, what pride they feel for those gains that they have achieved. But I also now we're hearing more about fear. They're becoming yet more afraid. And as we struggle with what our way forward should be, all along the emphasis has been on our Afghan national security forces. I can remember as a surge was put in place, being in Afghanistan and meeting with some of the young recruits and understanding what an extraordinary challenge it was going to be to train and equip these young people to get them to a place where they could replace the very professional efforts that we have brought to it. And so I'm just wondering, even as you talk about how a five-year plan might be an appropriate way forward, the issue of attrition has been an ongoing one. So given the challenge, as you bring in, you train and equip, you get these people up to a place, then you lose them. There's the cost to the billions of dollars spent on the effort. But also, I think we have to be realistic about what that attrition rate really, the impact it has on our long-term ability to transfer and be secure that this is a durable transfer to a security force that hasn't yet demonstrated that it can recruit and keep a security force that is up to the task. How are you dealing with the attrition rate? And I think it also has to be complicated by the death rate. I mean, I read alarming numbers of losses, and I can't imagine how that reverberates across Afghanistan as families are sending their people off to fight, rightfully so. I mean, this has to come down to them. But how are you dealing with those two elements?
Thank you for the question, ma'am. Attrition is one of the areas, one of the reform areas we work very hard with the Afghans. It's a couple different components. For me, it really gets down to leadership and holding leaders accountable to take care, understand their young men and women that join their services. They don't have the non-commissioned officer corps that we have in all of our services that really look at that discipline. If you recruit somebody in Badakhshan way in the north, put them down in Helmand and let them sit there for 3 years and fight, you know, he's not going to have the attitude that I want to continue to serve and stay there. You know, he has to be able to get on a cycle that he can sustain, to be able to train, be able to go see his family, and then fight. And they don't have that in their conventional army. We're working toward that. That's one of the reforms.
What is the attrition rate at this point, just a number?
Ma'am, I can come back to you with an exact number. The last couple of months, the recruiting has gone up. They're recontracting, what we would call reenlistment, keeping people in after their first term has gone up. So that's offset some of the attrition, but it continues to be an issue. They can train about 6,000 a month if they recruit that much. They'll maintain levels, no issue. But again, it gets down to leadership. They do have a working group, and we've had a task force on attrition headed by their vice chief of the Army, Lieutenant General Murad Ali. We have advisors that meet with him all the time to work on different issues to get after the recruiting and the recontracting. We brought experts from our recruiting command and the United States Army to Afghanistan for a very short time to take a look at all the processes and systems they have to make sure we can adjust those as they move forward. But it's putting attention on it. And President Ghani is starting to hold Corps commanders and other leadership accountable to really get after attrition. But it's going to take some time to continue to build that. But I think they do have the focus on that now.
Mr. Kaufman.
Hey, Mr. Chairman. General Campbell, I had the pleasure of visiting Afghanistan late last year and spent Thanksgiving with some of our troops and had the opportunity to meet with you as well. And while I was there, I had the opportunity to observe actually this was before, some of the ANA field artillery. And so I think my concern is, are we giving them weapon systems that are simply too complicated for them to effectively deploy as well as ever maintain? And so, and I don't know, and I don't know if this is this would be appropriate for a classified setting, if the ANA has been able to actually deploy that artillery. I think it's I think they were using a D-30 system. I wonder if you can comment on that.
Sure. Where, again, it comes where they've been trained in using the D-30. They do quite well. They do a lot more direct fire as opposed to indirect fire with the D-30s. We work with them on that. We work with them on preventing civilian casualties by using indirect fire, direct fire. But they have employed the D-30 in many places throughout Telmon and many places in the East. Again, it depends on which corps and how much emphasis they put on the training and how much the leadership actually understands about that. We've had advisors work with them specifically on the D-30. The chief of staff of the Army there recently appointed a new chief of field artillery. And so he's revamping, he's revamping the school and the training that goes along with the D-30 and all of the assets. They use a 60-millimeter mortar quite well, also in combat. But it boils down to if they've had the right training on that particular piece of equipment. And I think we got to continue to work with them on that.
Thank you, General Campbell. I think my concern with that, I think you mentioned 60-millimeter mortars, and which seems very appropriate for them. And given the capability of the enemy, that has essentially light mortars, some crew-served automatic weapons, small arms, IED capability, but that's RPGs, but that's pretty much it. And so I'm concerned about whenever we give them a major weapon systems that is complicated, that, you know, this artillery requires a lot of vehicle assets to be able to move it. Logistics are more complicated. Fire direction is much more complicated than light mortars. And individual infantry can move dismounted can move light mortars. And so I just think we need an evaluation across the board. But I want to commend you for your service and for all you've done. But I think I want to be fair to the Afghan security forces in having systems that they can readily deploy that are within their capability and their also their ability to maintain them. And so I think to be fair to them, to be fair to the taxpayers of the United States, to make sure that we're giving them the appropriate weapons and equipment.
Sure, thanks. And I think what President Ghani, Dr. Abdullah, the senior leadership that I deal with understand, when the United States provides equipment, you know, it's kind of one station does all. They get the training, they get the maintenance, and they get practical application on those on the equipment. So just like we do with A-29s, MD-530s, M4s, M16, NATO weapons, they get that training, they learn the maintenance of it. We do the same thing with the D-30s. D-30s were cobbled up many years ago from different nations. We're working now to make sure they have a standard D-30. They all have the same type of sight system on that, and we're working through that piece. They have the right lots of ammunition, and they know how to employ. But they do include the D-30 as part of their overall architecture for fire support. So when you talk close air support, they use the D-30 to provide some of that indirect fire when they plan for operations as they go forward. And they'll continue to get better, and I'll take a hard look at it, sir, as you've mentioned.
Thank you. Thank you, General Campbell. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Spear.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Campbell, everyone has commented on your great service to this country. I, too, would like to extend my congratulations. I also want to congratulate you on presenting probably the most well-written statement, clearest statement, that has been before this committee in some time. You were direct and to the point, and I appreciate that. Oftentimes, we get mixed messages. You were very clear in your presentation. Having said that, you made the point that 70% of Afghanistan is still under the control of the government. SIGAR, in its quarterly report, its most recent one, said that the Taliban now controls more territory than at any time since 2001. So that would suggest to me that we are not gaining ground. We may, in fact, be losing ground. So my question to you is, what should we be doing differently And what conditions should we be looking at to determine if our strategy is succeeding? And will the job ever be done there?
Thank you, ma'am. I think as we move forward again, we got to continue to work with the Afghan government, with the Afghan security forces, to increase their capability. And I do see changes in leadership. I do see changes in their ability to plan operations as they move forward. Again, the things that are very hard for the U.S. Army that's been around for 240 years is very tough for a army that's only been around for 8 or 9 years. And if we try to compare the two, then we'll make some bad comparisons. On the SOPCO, Mr. SOPCO and the SIGAR report of more than 2001, you know, in 2001, the Taliban controlled the government. They were in Kabul. You know, it's not like that today. So I'm not sure where that statement came from. It's totally different than 2001. And the Afghan government is in control of Afghanistan, and I told you about 70% influence control. So I'm not sure where the statement came from, Mr. Sopko, on that, or where the comparison 2001. I think as we move forward again, we have to make sure that we have realistic expectations on how fast they can move to be a force that can take care of Afghanistan and the people. But I do see that, you know, if I thought that the sacrifices we've made over the last 14, 15 years weren't worth it, if I thought that, you know, what we were doing there was not going to pay dividends, hasn't paid dividends, hadn't prevented another 9/11 from happening, you know, I would tell my son, who's in the Army, who the last time I saw my son, who's a sergeant, was in August of 2014 in Jalalabad on his second tour in Afghanistan. I talked to him 2 days ago. As I got back here, he's getting ready to deploy on his third tour. If I thought that it wasn't worth it, I would tell my own son, you know, you need to do something different. But I absolutely believe that the commitment of our young men and women as we move forward is going to make a difference, not only for the Afghan people, but for the security of our homeland. And we haven't had another 9/11 since we've been forward deployed. And I think sometimes we just kind of wish that away. And the world we live in is not that way. It's going to continue to be a dangerous world for the rest of our lives, and we have to do everything we can to build up capability for countries like Afghanistan to help us in that fight, and they want to do that.
So you referenced being clear-eyed about this. Do we have to accept the fact that we are there indefinitely, that we have to have a peacekeeping force there, much like we have in Korea?
And, you know, Korea, Germany, I've heard those references made before. You know, we had 300,000 plus one time. And when I first went to Germany as a second lieutenant, and we're down to probably between 20 and 30,000. In Korea, it's somewhere between 20 and 30,000. We're nowhere near those levels in Afghanistan. But yet we continue, although sometimes not as fast as we want, to continue to grow the capabilities of the Afghan security forces. I do believe we're going to have to continue to provide monetary support until the Afghans can pick that up on their own. I said that's at least till all the reports indicate at least to 2024 timeframe, where their economy will be able to support the Afghan people. They're completely on their own. They do continue to raise their commitment for their Afghan security forces, $500 million this past year. They'll continue to raise that every year. But I think, you know, we have to figure out what that balance is going to be. We have to figure out balancing the number of casualties that we have. And I believe the American people, understanding how important it is to have a presence in that part of the world and what it does, the second and third order effects, you know, that they'll continue to support as we go forward.
Maybe for the record, you could answer this last question. I'm running out of time. Wall Street Journal today says the rules of engagement need to change if we're really going to make some headway there. Maybe you can respond for the record for that.
Ma'am, I'll take for the record and a classified response. Thank you.
Mr. Gibson.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, General. You caught me by surprise yesterday when I learned of your retirement. It caused me to reflect on when I first met you. I think it was about 25 years ago when you were a major and I was a captain, and those were interesting times, but I don't think either of us could have anticipated what these past 25 years have wound up being. And General, you've always taken all the hard jobs, and I think of your honorable, faithful service over the years. I'm thinking at this moment of your time as a brigadier general in Baghdad. I know that was a very tough time. We lost a lot of great Americans then, and you know, I just want to say that when I think of you, I think of integrity, unflappable, mental and physical toughness, and dependable. So I thank you and your family. I want to take note of a comment you made earlier. You talked about leverage. When it comes to, you know, ensuring that the investments that we're making in Afghanistan come to fruition. And in my view, that was really among the most important lessons from Iraq. We quibble over some things, but I think that we really lost opportunities. We had significant leverage, the financial investments we were making there and other matters. And while we were seeing the deterioration, we saw a leader in Iraq at the time that was corrupt and really sectarian. And I think we missed a real opportunity to use leverage to change that. And so I just want to appreciate that comment. But my question to you, and by the way, I hope that the administration is listening, sort of a segue to the last point, which is as we think about going forward from here and for the next president, I would love for you to tell us, because I accept the point you make that as hard as matters have been in Afghanistan, by keeping the pressure on them over there, we're protecting the American people here. And so if you were able to change things in any way, how would we improve our counterterrorism in Afghanistan and in Pakistan, but really, so specifically there, but then in general, what lessons, what changes in policy would be necessary so that we can improve our counterterrorism?
Well, thanks for the question, and thanks for your service as well, all the way. And that's a great question as we move forward. I think for me, what I reflect on, from a CT counterterrorism perspective, when I got there 18 months ago, as we were going to go to 1,000 Kabul centric, there is no CT strategy. And what we've done is been able to push that, and we do now have a counterterrorism strategy in that part of the world as we move forward. And I think we do have to continue as part of that strategy to build the Afghan forces up so they can take that over. That's going to take a long time. As you know, the men and women that we have that do CT have been doing this for many years, and they take great pride in their precision on their ability to gain the intelligence that's required, on and on and on. And I think as we move forward, what we have to do is continue to rely on lessons learned, go back and take a look at everything that we've done. We can always get better. But I think, there are, and I don't want to get out of the lane on policy, I do believe that there are issues throughout the world, not just on Afghanistan, on how we can apply policy different, apply pressure that ultimately will get after this this global generational threat, terrorism, which knows no boundaries. And I think part of it is getting the rest of the global community to help fight this. It can't just be the U.S., although they depend on the U.S. to lead the way. We shouldn't forget that. Even with NATO, they didn't make the decision to continue Resolute support longer until the U.S. made its decision. That's how they depend upon our leadership and understand how important that leadership is. And so I think in the world of CT, there are things that we can do throughout the world that probably we ought to talk in a classified hearing, not to give our enemies an advantage here, that we could do a little bit differently. But we have the greatest CT capability in the world, and it continues, I think, to get better and better under the leadership of guys like Joe Votel and Tony Thomas and others. So I'm proud to have been able to work with all those forces, both in Iraq and Afghanistan, over the last 14, 15 years.
Thank you, General. And as we all go forward, I think it's important that you think about, you mentioned NATO being involved here, and really all of our friends and allies, and thinking across the spectrum in terms of intelligence required, force protection, all the assets that are going to be necessary for us to prevail. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back.
Mr. Takai.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Aloha, General Campbell. Thank you for your service in Afghanistan and candor with this committee. As we make adjustments to our funding commitments in Afghanistan in light of the budget pressures, what metrics are we measuring the Afghan National Defense and Security Forces capabilities such that we can reduce our support?
So again, a lot of that is, when we first started there, and I said we were in the $12 to $13 billion range. We were building a lot of infrastructure. We were providing a lot of equipment, arms. We don't have to do that now. So we just have to provide really, we look at providing life cycle sustainment. So that's really cut down the amount of money, and we'll continue to work through that. As we deal with the Afghan forces on the monetary piece, we do look at making sure they understand, what's very tough for us, PBB&E, which is really the planning, programming, budgeting, execution. We have advisors there, senior-level advisors that work with senior-level Afghans on budgeting, on programming, on their procurement. President Ghani chairs personally, and Dr. Abdullah chairs personally, a procurement meeting every Saturday night. It goes 2 or 3 hours as they work on how they can cut out corruption, how they can get the right kind of contracts in there. He's definitely taking that on as, you know, trying to help cut out corruption. So that's going to help us continue to bring down. But we have to build our capability in that. And in the past, where many of our, you know, our weapon systems were our young men and women out there fighting every day, Shona by Shona, side by side, shoulder by shoulder with them. Now our weapon systems are our senior advisors, senior civilians that come over, senior military folks of all our services that work in the very tough areas of planning, programming, budgeting, execution, intelligence reforms, transparency and accountability, rule of law, those kind of things. And I think as we continue to build their capability, they'll get more efficient and we can continue to bring down the funding. But we use conditions, again, to apply pressure to make sure they understand that there is a sense of urgency here, that we got to continue to move forward, and they understand that and they want to make changes. But it is about changing behavior. And so you can't continue to do the same old thing, and you have to apply different ways to change behavior.
Is it fair to suggest that increased support from U.S. contractors will be necessary to supplant the decrease in active duty military support?
Sure. We've depended on contractors for years in many critical areas, both in Iraq and Afghanistan. We do offset the number of military on the ground by the number of contractors. We do look at that very hard. Try to keep that in balance, but I think for the foreseeable future, we'll continue to have contractors involved. Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Well, I know you have rightfully been focused on helping the Afghans fight the Taliban, ISIS, and Al-Qaeda. My other assignment from HASC is the ranking member of the Contracting the Workforce Subcommittee on the Small Business Committee. I wanted to concentrate for a minute on the U.S. contractors that enable you to perform your mission. You mentioned them just a few minutes ago. Some of which participate as small businesses. It is my understanding that they are having significant challenges in dealing with the Afghan government in a number of areas, such as tax disputes, attaining new or renewing licenses, and generally staying compliant with Afghan law. At some point, these issues will impact you and your successors' ability to perform the mission and reach our objectives. The contractors can't fix this alone. It must be a government-to-government solution. What is Resolute Support doing to help facilitate a solution to these challenges?
So that's the second question brought up on the contractor piece and the issues they may have. I'll go back and make sure we're attuned to that. We do have the BSA and a task force that works both with the Afghans. The Afghans have a piece of that, Resolute Support, and all of the embassies, especially the U.S. on the BSA, work toward that. The first meeting actually was last week, I think, at a lower level. It'll come to both myself and the Minister of Defense, who will sit those. And these kind of issues, if not worked out at a lower level, will then be brought forward. And I'll make sure that we take a hard look on any of the taxing issues or licensing issues. Again, I know President Ghani, Dr. Abdullah, are very attuned to making sure that they create opportunities inside of Afghanistan, not only for the Afghans to continue to build up and build business, but also they're going to need help from outside. And if they're doing things that obstruct that, and as it impacts on a security perspective, we'll make sure that we get after that. But I'll go take a harder deep dive on that and make sure we're addressing that fully.
Okay, thank you. I believe the bilateral security agreement and the NDAA says that these types of taxes are improper. In fact, we just met recently with a company that says that they are facing a $63 million tax bill. So this is a big issue that needs to be resolved. So if you can get back to us, I'd appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Absolutely. Thank you.